माधव कुंज बिहारी। जय गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी। गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी। यशोदा नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन। यशोदा नंदन ब्रज जन रंजन। यमुना तीरा वनचारी। यमुना तीरा वनचारी। जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी। जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी। जय ओम विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिव्राजकाचार्य अष्टोत्तर सत हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस अभय चरणारविंद भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। श्री श्री राधा श्याम सुंदर ललिता विशाखा की जय। श्री श्री कृष्ण बलराम की जय। श्री श्री गौर निताय की जय। श्री वृंदावन धाम की जय। श्री गिरि गोवर्धन की जय। श्री प्रहलाद महाराज की जय। निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे समवेत भक्त वृंद की जय। समवेत भक्त वृंद की जय। समवेत भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री गुरु गौरांग की जय। ओम ज्ञान तिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं। वंदेहं श्री गुरु श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्री गुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्री रूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्री राधा कृष्ण पादां सहगण ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च। नमो ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्ण प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांछाकल्पतरूभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे। हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। I'm very happy to be back, or rather for the first time actually, with the devotees at the Bhagavat Vidyapeeth. You are all very fortunate to be studying in this place, in Govardhan, and learning Srimad Bhagavatam and other related scriptures. I'm sure that by now you have gone through a substantial portion of not just the Bhakti Shastri books, but also the Srimad Bhagavatam itself. The topic I was requested to speak on today is the devotion of Prahlad Maharaj. So what I will do is, I will take up a certain small section of the fourth chapter of the seventh canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, the glories of the devotion of Prahlad Maharaj are mentioned in numerous places in the Srimad Bhagavatam, especially in the seventh canto. So it is not possible for us to touch upon all those places where his devotion is glorified. However, I will just take this one small section. This fourth chapter is titled Hiranyakashipu Terrorizes the Universe. But at the end of this chapter, after the terrorism of Hiranyakashipu has been described, and by the way, terrorism is not a new phenomenon. It has existed from time immemorial. Hiranyakashipu was the Adi terrorist, the original terrorist. So anyway, after a description of the terrorism of Hiranyakashipu, now we are reading in the Srimad Bhagavatam about the glories of Prahlad Maharaj. So we come to the 30th verse and we start from there, where Narad Muni, who is speaking this to Yudhishthir Maharaj, explains that Prahlad was not the only son of Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu had four sons. And amongst them, though, Prahlad, Mahams Tesham, Tesham is amongst them, amongst the four sons, Chatvaraha, amongst the four sons of Prahlad, of Hiranyakashipu, Prahlad was Mahams. He was Mahan, he was the greatest. Why so? Because Parama Adbhutaha, Gunaihi. Because of his gunaihi, his qualities, his transcendental qualities, which were extraordinarily, Parama means supreme, and adbhuta means extraordinary or astonishing. So the transcendental qualities of Prahlad Maharaj were astonishing and extraordinary, and that is what made him stand out amongst the four brothers. Now, generally, from a materialistic viewpoint, what stands out for people are material qualities. So people are glorified in this world for the kind of material qualities they may have. But from a spiritual point of view, we understand that the real object of glorification should be the spiritual qualities. So since Prahlad was a reservoir of these transcendental qualities, he stood out amongst these four sons, and indeed amongst everybody, amongst the entire population there. And therefore he's called Mahan, the greatest amongst the four. Srila Prabhupada mentions here that Prahlad is praised herein for having all the good qualities because of worshipping the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Mahat Upasakaha. Upasana refers to worship. So because he was such a great worshipper or a great devotee of the Supreme Lord, therefore he acquired all these Param Adbhutaha Gunaihi. So in other words, when we serve Krishna with great faith and sincerity under the proper guidance, then we become endowed with transcendental qualities. What kind of transcendental qualities? As in the Bhagavatam here, yasyasti bhakteir bhagavati akinchana sarveir gunaistatra samasate suraha. So the Bhagavatam says that for one who is akinchana, who has no other desires, and bhagavati bhakti, so one who has डिवोशन और भक्ति अप टू भगवान भगवती. द वर्ड भगवान कम्स फ्रॉम भगवत. सो भगवत एंड भगवती मीन्स अंतु भगवत और भगवान. सो फॉर वन हु इज एन अनअलॉयड डिवोटी ऑफ भगवान श्री कृष्ण हैज नो अदर डिजायर्स सर्वैर गुणैः तत्र समासते सुराः. Suraha refers to all the demigods. So, sarveir gunehi. So, all the qualities of the demigods, they also reside in that great devotee. And Srila Jiva Goswami has also commented that essentially it's not only the qualities of the demigods, because even if the demigods are very exalted, they also worship pure devotees like Prahlad, as we shall see shortly. Therefore, Jiva Goswami says that the qualities that such exalted devotees like Prahlad have are not merely those that exist in the demigods, but indeed those that exist in the Supreme Lord himself. Now, naturally, because the living entity cannot be equal to the Supreme Lord in all respects, the quantitative aspect of those qualities will not be the same. But nevertheless, the qualities do exist in minute quantity in the great devotees like Prahlad. And that comes about because of devotion. So we see here that this is a very important point. The root is devotional service to Krishna. From devotional service to Krishna, which is performed with faith, sincerity, and devotion, then comes all the desirable transcendental qualities. Now, in order to save time, the next two verses, I will simply read the translation of the verses that Srila Prabhupada has given. The qualities of Prahlad Maharaj, the son of Hiranyakashipu, are described herewith. He was completely cultured as a qualified Brahmana, having a very good character, and being determined to understand the absolute truth. He had full control of his senses and mind. Like the super soul, he was kind to every living entity and was the best friend of everyone. To respectable persons, he acted like a menial servant. To the poor, he was like a father. To his equals, he was attached like a sympathetic brother. And he considered his teachers, spiritual masters, and older God brothers to be as good as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He was completely free from unnatural pride that might have arisen from his good education, riches, beauty, aristocracy, and so on. Brahmanyah, cultured as a good Brahmana. Shila Sampannaha. Shila refers to one who is very well behaved, who has all the qualities. Sampanna means to be endowed with. So he had all the qualities of a cultured person, and the highest culture is the state of devotion to Lord Krishna. So one who becomes a pure devotee of Lord Krishna automatically is the most cultured person and is endowed with all the good qualities. And Prabhupada mentions in the purport that these are some of the qualifications of a Vaishnava. So, because Krishna has unlimited transcendental qualities, therefore Krishna's devotees also have unlimited transcendental qualities. It is not possible to enumerate all the qualities of a devotee. Although, sometimes in the scriptures we do find that there is mention of such qualities. For example, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, we see the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu speaks of the 26 qualities of a Vaishnava. Now, it doesn't mean that these are the only 26 qualities that a devotee has. The devotee can have many more qualities as well. So here also, this list of qualities is not an exhaustive or a complete list. And Prabhupada Goda and Narad Muni goes on to say that even though Prahlad Maharaj was born in a family of asuras, and therefore technically by birth he was an asura, still he was a great devotee of Lord Vishnu. And his qualities were that he was never envious of Vaishnavas. The qualities of asuras is that, generally speaking, they are envious of devotees. They don't like devotees so much. At least mostly, that's the characteristic. And Prabhupada mentions in the purport, the important point here is that we discover that a man is not qualified or disqualified simply by birth. But Prahlad Maharaj was an asura by birth, yet he possessed all the qualities of a perfect brahmana. Brahmanyaha shila sampannaha. Anyone can become a fully qualified brahmana under the direction of a spiritual master. So therefore we see that birth is not actually a disqualification. It may be an impediment or it may be something favorable. In the sense that a person born in a family of devotees has a better chance to become a devotee because he or she is exposed to a devotional atmosphere and devotional teachings and practices and those samskaras right from childhood. So definitely there is a very good chance. It's a favorable situation to become a devotee, but it's not necessary. The person may not become a devotee, at least in this life. Or at least overtly not become a devotee. On the other hand, the person born in a non-devotee family by virtue of his or her past devotion, by past I mean in the previous lives, may become a devotee also. So therefore, even though birth and, it may be an impediment or maybe something favorable, it is not necessarily so. So one may overcome or one may contradict the negativities or the positivities of one's situation at birth and turn out to be something quite opposite. And there is nothing so stark a contrast possible as Prahlad, as the case of Prahlad. Because Hiranyakashipu was a very, very powerful demon. He was the king of the demons. So Asura Variya, as Prahlad has addressed him elsewhere in this canto, that he's the best amongst the asuras, the greatest amongst the asuras. He was the most demoniac amongst all the demoniac people. And a person is known by his activities. So if you look at Hiranyakashipu's activities earlier on in this fourth chapter, we will see exactly how demoniac he was. And still we find that a great devotee like Prahlad was born as his son. Of course, we know that's because also his mother was favorably inclined. She heard from Narad Muni, and Prahlad also became a follower of Narad Muni when he was in his mother's womb. So therefore, devotional mercy, the mercy of devotees and devotional instructions can often transcend the limitations of one's material situation. And this is brought out best in the life of Prahlad. So then Narad Muni goes on to say, Yasmin Mahatgunarajan Grihyante Kavibhir Mohu. So Yasmin, in whom Mahatgunaha. So in Prahlad, that is in whom resided all these transcendental qualities, Grihyante, they are glorified. By whom? Kavibhihi. Kavi refers to not just a poet, but in Sanskrit, the word kavi also refers to philosophers. Brahma, for example, is the Adi Kavi, as indicated in the first verse of the Bhagavatam. So great philosophers, great devotees, great munis, great scholars. So the great qualities of Prahlad Maharaj have been glorified, muhuhu, always, repeatedly. And nate adhuna idhiyante. And it is not that these qualities have been obscured or covered over because of the long lapse of time. You see, sometimes we may forget, out of sight, out of mind, things like that. We may forget somebody's glories.
But not so with Prahlad Maharaj. That is why Ramananda Rai says that the greatest fame is that of a devotee. Otherwise, kings in history and so on, they may be glorified for some years, some centuries, maybe a few thousand years at the most. But then they are forgotten. Whereas great devotees like Prahlad are remembered, glorified in the society of the most exalted spiritualists for all time. It is always the case, and never does time or circumstance erase such a glorification of the divine qualities of a great soul like Prahlad Maharaj. Yatha Bhagavatishvare, just as the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna's qualities exist forever in transcendental glory, so also does the glory of the qualities of a great devotee like Prahlad Maharaj. Now, there is something extraordinary that is mentioned here in the purport by Srila Prabhupada. Now, what Prabhupada is mentioning here is that Prahlad Maharaj lives simultaneously in Vaikuntha Loka, in the spiritual world, and also in Sutala Loka, which is one of the lower planets in the material world. It is one of the Bilasvarga Loka. Bila is subterranean, below the earth. So there is Svarga Loka, which is above the earth, and there is Bilasvarga, subterranean spiritual of material planets, as mentioned in the fifth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So Prahlad Maharaj exists in both places simultaneously. And Srila Prabhupada explains that the transcendental quality of existing simultaneously in different places is another qualification of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Because he exists in everybody's heart. So, and all of us are located differently. So he's present in one person's heart, in another person's heart, in another person's heart. And despite all of this, he's also simultaneously present in the spiritual world. So Prabhupada says here, a devotee acquires qualities almost the same as those of the Lord because of unalloyed devotional service. Ordinary living beings cannot be so qualified, but a devotee can be qualified like the Supreme Personality of Godhead, not in full, but partially. So we understand that because of the greatness of the devotion of Prahlad, he acquired qualities almost like the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Not in full, but partially, as Prabhupada clarifies. But the idea of being simultaneously present in many places at the same time exists infinitely in the Supreme Lord. So he can exist in, he does indeed exist in every atom, in every living entity's heart. He exists in every planet in the spiritual world also. So he's everywhere. So the individual living entity, even if he's a great devotee, cannot be as all-pervasive as Krishna is, but he can exist at several places at the same time. That quality exists because of great devotion. So this is an important point, that the comparison being made here, yatha bhagavatishvare, that as the divine qualities exist in the Supreme Personality of Godhead, always, irrespective of time, place, circumstance, similarly, the divine qualities of Prahlad Maharaj are never obscured or covered or hidden or lost because of time, place, and circumstance. And because of this, Prahlad remains a subject to be discussed and glorified all over the universe, in every material universe. And of course, naturally, he's a resident of the spiritual world as well. So Narad Muni says, Yam sadhu gatha sadasi ripavo pi suran ripa. To sadhu gatha sadasi. So gatha refers to the katha or the glorification. So whenever sadhu gatha sadasi, whenever the sadhus gather together in an assembly to glorify the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his devotees, and the process of devotional service, undoubtedly, you know, this Prahlad's example is also discussed. And by whom? Not just in a society of, those who are, shall we say, in the same family as Prahlad, descendants of Prahlad, but even by the enemies of the Asuras, Ripavaha. Ripu indicates an enemy. So now, because Prahlad was born in a family of Asuras, although he himself was a great devotee and not an Asura, but because traditionally the Asuras, the demons on one hand, and the Suras or the demigods on the other hand, have been inimical to each other. So because Prahlad was born in a family of Asuras, therefore technically the Devas or the demigods were his enemies. But because Prahlad was such a great devotee, even though he was born in a family of Asuras, the demigods glorified him. So whenever in the higher planets of the universe, there is discussion, and that happens a lot, there is a discussion on the glories of Krishna and devotees, then Prahlad's name is invariably mentioned. And Prahlad's example is cited as an example of great devotees. So Narad Muni says, Kim uta anye bhavadrishaha. Then if it is so in the case of the enemies of the Asuras, or so-called enemies of Prahlad, what then to speak of others like you? Kim uta kaimutya nyaya. Kim uta indicates, you know, the kaimutya nyaya is, if for it is so much for this, then how much more for that? So if the enemies of Prahlad, not actually personally of Prahlad, but of the family of Prahlad, if they can glorify Prahlad so much, then what then to speak of others? And especially like you, O Yudhishthir Maharaj. Kim uta anye bhava bhavadrishaha. Exalted personalities like yourself. So Narad Muni is glorifying Yudhishthir Maharaj. Yudhishthir Maharaj is, of course, another great and exalted devotee of Krishna. In the Bhagavatam, he has been also called Haridas, along with other personalities like Uddhava and Govardhan. Govardhan is also called Haridasa Varya. Best amongst all, Uddhava is also called Haridas in Yudhishthir. So Narad Muni, the spiritual master, is glorifying the disciple and saying he's glorifying his disciple Yudhishthir as being exalted. So if Prahlad is such a great devotee that he can be glorified even in the community of enemies of his family, what then to speak of great devotees like yourself and other devotees, O Yudhishthir Maharaj? This is how Narad Muni explains it. And then he goes on to say, Gunair alum asankhyeyair mahat mahatmyam tasya suchyate vasudeve bhagavati yasya naisargiki ratihi. Gunai alam asankhyeyaihi. Asankhyeyaihi means those which are asankhya, innumerable. Sankhya means to count. Asankhya means not count or uncountable. So because his transcendental qualities are countless, mahatmyam tasya suchyate. So his qualities are so great because of Vasudeva Bhagavati, because of his devotion, his attraction to the Lord, to Vasudev, was naisargiki ratihi. Rati indicates attachment. Naisargiki indicates natural. The word nisarga indicates natural, and naisargiki is that which comes from something that happens very spontaneously or naturally. It is not something that is by imitation or by some kind of, shall we say, a kind of a practice, etc. It's just spontaneous and natural. So this is a very important term in relation to the devotion of Prahlad. Naisargiki ratihi. That his devotion was natural. And that is where his greatness really lies. This is what Srila Jiva Goswami comments on this verse. That the greatness of Prahlad Maharaj lies in his naisargiki ratihi, in the natural or spontaneous attraction that he had for the Supreme Lord. So naturally, this is the greatest quality of Prahlad. Similarly, we see that when the qualities of a great devotee are described, the qualities of devotion and surrender to the Supreme Lord are the most prominent amongst them, and they are the Swarupa Lakshana. They are the main, quality. And the others are Gauna Lakshana. They are the secondary qualities which emanate from that Mukhya Lakshana, that primary quality. If the quality of devotion is there, then all other good qualities automatically come. So in this way, here also, Prabhupada says, Prahlad Maharaj's attachment for Narasimhadev was attachment for Krishna, Vasudev, the son of Vasudev. So this is important because Prahlad, the Lord appeared before Prahlad for the first time as in the form of Narasimhadev. Then the next verse is also very important here. Nyasta kridanako balo jadavat tanmanastaya krishna graha grihitatma naveda jagati drisham. Nyasta means to give up. Kridanakaha indicates that which is meant for krida, for play, which means essentially toys. Because little children are very much fond of playing, and they are fond of objects of playing, like toys and so on. So even though he was a balaha, he was a small boy, but he was not interested in frivolous activities like children generally are, including playing and toys and such things. So nyasta kridanakaha balaha. And jadavat tanmanastaya. And therefore he acted as if he was dull. This reminds us also of Maharaj Rahugana, of Jadabharata, I beg your pardon, when he was speaking to Rahugana. So he was misunderstood because Rahugana was not able to recognize what a great devotee Jadabharata was. So similarly, Prahlad appeared to others to be jada, that means dull and silent. But the reason was not that he was dull, he was quite the opposite, he was the most intelligent. But he appeared so because tan manastaya, his mind was fully absorbed in Krishna. So manaha, manaha refers to the mind, tat refers here to Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Because Prahlad's mind was totally and always absorbed in Krishna, therefore he appeared to the outside world to be dull and silent. And because of his absorption in Krishna constantly, na veda jagat idrisham, na veda jagat. Jagat refers to the entire world. Veda means to understand. No, so he did not understand how the world was going on around him. Because of his internal absorption, he was quite unaware of how the world is going on around him. And an important phrase is used here by Narad Muni. Just like the phrase, Naisargiki Ratihi, was very important from the previous verse. Similarly, the phrase graha, Krishna graha, grihita atma is very important for us. So graha refers to a planet. Now, as you all know, we all are influenced to lesser or greater degrees by the planets. They reflect our karma. They indicate our karma. So therefore, by Jyotish Shastra, we understand that when the planets are in a certain position in our chart, then that indicates what kind of situation we will be in, how much suffering we will get, or how much happiness we will get, or other events in our life, and so on. So there are some planets that are considered malevolent or malefic, that is bad. Some are considered very favorable, right? So generally, people would like to be under the influence of the good planets and try to avoid the influence of the bad planets. And when the influence of the bad planets is there in the chart, astrological chart, then a good astrologer would recommend some parihara or something to counteract the ill effects of the malefic planets. So all this goes on the material platform. So this is ordinary grahas. But the perfect solution for transcending not only the malefic grahas, but also the other positive influencing grahas, because that's also material ultimately, is to come under the influence of Krishna graha, the Krishna planet, which means to be totally Krishna conscious. So whilst we do recognize Jyotish Shastra, we understand its importance as a Vedic science. We do not denigrate it and dismiss it as something that is unscientific, etc. And we may, in a limited way, in a very careful way, utilize this science. But ultimately, we should know that we are not interested in being under the good planets or the bad planets of this universe. We are interested in being under the influence of the Krishna planet. That is what Prahlad was. And that is precisely the stage of pure devotion. One can be under the Krishna planet only when one is in devotion to Krishna, when one loves Krishna. So the word grihita, atma, indicates that one who has accepted grahana. Grihita atma is one who has got fully accepted or fully attracted to the Krishna graha. So the strongest influence in the life of Prahlad was not Shani or Surya or Chandra or whatever, but the strongest influence in the life of Prahlad was Krishna. So when we say Krishna graha, we want to be under the influence of Krishna graha like Prahlad was, we mean that we want to be under the influence of Krishna. Of course, devotee, non-devotee, etc., whoever we may be, whatever we may be, everyone is under the influence of Krishna, directly or indirectly. And here is the difference, that a devotee likes to be directly under the influence of control of Krishna, whereas a non-devotee does not like to be under the control of anybody. But a non-devotee does not understand that actually he or she is not independent at all. There is one German philosopher, a writer, a famous person called Goethe. I just remembered that quote of his. I'm paraphrasing it. He says that there is no one so helplessly bound as one who falsely thinks he's independent. Of course, Goethe was not a devotee, so he was thinking in material terms, most likely. But we can apply that principle from a spiritual point of view. So people think that they're independent, but actually they're not. They're always under the control of Krishna, but when they are not directly under the control of Krishna, they are under the control of the planets, of the material world. But our idea is to move out from under the control of the material planets and move directly under the control of Krishna Graha, to be directly under the control of Krishna, which means to enter the realm of pure devotional service. So here, na veda jagat. So he could not understand how the world goes on. And in the next verse, Narad Muni says, he indicates exactly how this happened. Na veda jagat, that he could not understand how the world goes on, is elaborated in the next verse here, where Narad Muni says, Asinaha paryatan ashnam shayanaha prapiban bhuvan nanu sandhatta etani govinda parirambhitaha. Ashina ashinaha means while sitting. Paryatan, which means whilst walking. Ashnam means while eating. Shayanaha, while lying down or sleeping. Prapiban, while drinking. Bhruvan, while talking. Na anusandhatte etani. He did not understand how these activities were being automatically performed. Anusandhatte indicates new, knowing. Na anusandhatte etani. Etani means these. So which? These referring to all these activities like eating, lying down, drinking, talking, walking. He did not understand how these activities that his body was performing were going on. And why did he not understand? Govinda parirambhitaha. Parirambhitaha, strictly speaking, indicates embraced. So because he was embraced by Krishna, or we can say embraced by the love of Krishna, so he was so absorbed in that thought of Krishna that he was completely detached from how his body interacted with the world. And the purport that is given here by Srila Prabhupada is also very instructive and enlightening. So Prabhupada says here, and I'm quoting, a small child, while being cared for by his mother, does not know how the needs of the body for eating, sleeping, lying down, passing water and evacuating are being fulfilled. He is simply satisfied to be on the lap of his mother. Similarly, Prahlad Maharaj was exactly like a small child being cared for by Govinda. The necessary activities of his body were performed without his knowledge. As a father and mother care for their child, Govinda cared for Prahlad Maharaj, who remained always absorbed in thoughts of Govinda. This is Krishna consciousness. Prahlad Maharaj is a vivid example of perfection in Krishna consciousness. So very, very important example, an indication that he was completely detached from this world. So his activities are going on. He's eating, he's sleeping, he talks, he walks, sits down. But because his mind, he does it in a routine way, in a routine fashion, because it has to be done. When one has this material body and one is living in the material world, then one has to go through the motions of all the actions that have to be performed. Just like to give an example, a crude example of a person who may be, thinking of something else very deeply. You know, his mind is so absorbed in some problem or in some sorrow or in some happiness of something, etc. But he does his other activities just, not with his heart, and he doesn't even know what he's doing. He just does it. His mind is always dwelling on something else. So here, Prahlad was in the situation where, because his mind was totally absorbed in Krishna, he did not know how these activities were going on. Now, we know from our study of Bhagavad Gita that something similar is being mentioned in the fifth chapter of Bhagavad Gita.
where Krishna says, naiva kinchit karomi iti yukto manyeta tattvavit pashyan shrinvan sprishan jikran ashnan gachan svapan shvasan. And he goes on to say, pralapan visrijan grihanan unmishan nimishan napi indriyani indriyartheshu vartanta iti dharayan. So here, what Krishna is saying in the fifth chapter, he's describing the condition of a person who's tattvavit. Vit as in Vedavit, tattvavit, one who knows the tattva or the truth. And he's yuktaha. Yuktaha means engaged. So engaged in what? In the verses previous to this, Krishna has mentioned yoga yuktaha, vishuddhatma. So he's speaking about yoga yukta, and bhakti yoga is the ultimate yoga. So one who is fully engaged in devotional service is a vishuddha atma, who is completely purified. So these two verses of the Bhagavad Gita describe the condition of how such a person, a yoga yukta vishuddha atma, interacts with the world. How do his senses interact with the world? So it says, na eva kinchit karomi iti manyeta. Manyeta means he thinks. So how does he think? Na eva kinchit karomi. I am not doing all these activities. At any time, none of these activities are being done by me. He understands that ultimately Krishna is the doer. So whether it is Pashyan, when he's seeing, Shrinvan, he's hearing, Sprishan, he's touching something, Jigran, he's smelling something, Ashnan, he's eating, Gachan, he's going, Svapan, he's dreaming or sleeping, Shvasan, he's breathing, Pralapan, he's talking, Visrijan means he's giving up something, Grahanan means he's accepting something, Unmishan, Nimishan, he's opening his eyes or he's closing his eyes. So while in the midst of all these activities, these 10 or 12 or 13 activities that Krishna mentions in these two verses, Indriyani, Indriyartheshu. So he understands that his senses are being engaged with the sense objects. But because he doesn't identify with the material body, he understands that he is the spirit soul, he's not this body. And that this body is interacting with its objects. The eyes are interacting with the form. The tongue is interacting with some foodstuffs and tasting things. So he says, Vartanta. So let my senses be engaged with the sense objects in this way. Let it be. Iti dharayan. Vartanta iti dharayan. So he considers that ultimately Krishna is the doer. Meanwhile, let my senses be engaged with their objects in the way that they are. I will continue to be absorbed in my spiritual consciousness. So the idea that I am not the doer, na eva kinchit karomi, and the idea that indriyani indriyartheshu vartanta iti dharayan, that let this be just an engagement of the senses with the sense objects, is not something that can be artificially imitated or misinterpreted as being that we can do anything we like and justify it by saying, I'm not the body and the senses are acting with their objects. So here it means that it has to be authorized. Prahlad Maharaj was acting in authorized ways, because he is the disciple of none other than Narad Muni himself. And here is Narad Muni, Prahlad's spiritual master, glorifying his disciple Prahlad to another of his disciples, Yudhishthir Maharaj. So Narad Muni goes on to say, Kvachit rudati vaikuntha chinta shabala chetanaha kvachit dhasati tat chinta lada udgayati kvachit. We're running out of time, so I'll be a little quick. So, kvachit rudati. Sometimes he would cry. Why would he cry? Vaikuntha chinta. by thoughts of Krishna or Vaikuntha. Vaikuntha is the spiritual world. Because of his absorption in Krishna, so he used to sometimes cry. Shabala Chetanaha. So his mind became sometimes bewildered by that, you know, flustered because of his absorption in Krishna. Kochit Hasati Tachinta. And sometimes he would laugh. Tachinta Hlad Udgayati Kochit. And sometimes being very jubilant, he would chant very loudly. He would sing very loudly. And Prabhupada further mentions in the purport here that this verse clarifies the comparison of a devotee to a child. Unquote. So Prabhupada is elaborating on the comparison of the child in the and a Prahlad situation. If a mother leaves her small child in his bed or cradle and goes away to attend to some family duties, the child immediately understands that his mother has gone away and therefore he cries. But as soon as the mother returns and cares for the child laughs and becomes jubilant. Similarly, Prahlad Maharaj, being always absorbed in thoughts of Krishna, sometimes felt separation, thinking, where is Krishna? This is explained by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Shunyayitam jagat sarvam govinda virahena me. When an exalted devotee feels that Krishna is invisible, having gone away, he cries in separation. And sometimes when he sees that Krishna has returned to care for him, he laughs. Just as a child sometimes laughs upon understanding that his mother is taking care of him. These symptoms are called bhava. And Narad Muni continues. He says, Nadati kvachit utkantho. Nadati means to speak loudly. So sometimes he would speak very loudly. Utkantho. Utkantha means in great eagerness, in great anxiety. Vilajjaha means without any sense of shame or embarrassment. What will others think of me? There was no consideration of that. Nrityati kvachit. Sometimes he would dance. Kvachit tad bhavana yuktaha tanmayo uchakaraha. So sometimes he would be so absorbed in thoughts of Krishna. He felt oneness, tanmayaha. And anuchakara, he imitated the pastimes of Krishna. So tanmaya here indicates to feel the oneness. Now, again, this oneness is not the oneness of the Mayavadis, where the devotee physically wants to merge into Krishna and become Krishna ontologically. The spirit, the bhava, or the mood is of being so absorbed in thoughts of Krishna. So here the tanmaya refers to chinmaya, or, you know, in the mind. So anuchakara. Imitate that in that bhav, Prahlad used to imitate the pastimes of Krishna. And one recollects at this time that the gopis did similarly, as is explained in the 10th canto. When Krishna disappeared from their midst and went away, the gopis became almost mad in anxiety of separation from Krishna. And among the other things they did was to imitate the pastimes of Krishna. One gopi became Putana, another became Krishna. Another gopi became an asura, and another gopi became Krishna, killing that asura, and so on and so forth. So that happens in this very, very elevated state of consciousness. So Prabhupada mentions in the purport, Prahlad Maharaj sometimes felt that the Lord was far away from him, and therefore he called him loudly. When he saw that the Lord was before him, he was fully jubilant. Sometimes thinking himself one with the Supreme, he imitated the Lord's pastimes, and in separation from the Lord, he would sometimes show symptoms of madness. These feelings of a devotee would not be appreciated by impersonalists. Unquote.
So this is an important point here. So here the relationship between Prahlad is that he was thinking of the Lord in terms of Vatsalya, that is, the Lord is like a parent and he's like the child. Here the feelings of Prahlad Maharaj were in the mellow of Vatsalya, filial love and affection. As a child cries when left by his mother, when Prahlad Maharaj felt the Lord was far away from him, he began to cry, Nadati. Again, a devotee like Prahlad sometimes sees the Lord is coming from a long distance to pacify him, like a mother responding to a child saying, my dear child, do not cry, I'm coming. Then the devotee, without being ashamed due to his surroundings and circumstances, begins to dance thinking, here is my Lord is coming. Thus, the devotee in full ecstasy sometimes imitates the pastimes of the Lord, just as a cowherd boy used to imitate the behavior of jungle animals. However, he does not actually become the Lord. Prahlad Maharaj achieved the spiritual ecstasies described herein by his advancement in spiritual understanding. And the last verse before I stop is, I'll just translate to save time. Sometimes feeling the touch of the Lord's lotus hands, he became spiritually jubilant and remained silent, his hair standing on end and tears gliding down from his half-closed eyes because of his love for the Lord. So this is a small section of the Bhagavatam in which the devotion of Prahlad Maharaj has been glorified by none other than another associate of the Lord and by his own spiritual master, Narad Muni. Okay, so thank you very much. And I'm very happy to be with the Bhagavat Mahavidyalaya. I am a great supporter of the Bhagavat Mahavidyalaya, and I'm very happy at this initiative that has happened. And I do hope and pray that this project will continue on and move on from strength to strength, and that you get all the support that you need to continue this wonderful project. I'm sure Srila Prabhupada will be very pleased with this. So thank you all very much for this opportunity to speak something. Hare Krishna. And by the way, I also hope that all of you are safe and well in the midst of this pandemic. I do hope all of you are taking all the required precautions and not taking anything lightly. Devotees are very, very precious, so do take care. So I think there is some questions. Yeah, I think Raghunath Prabhu has raised his hand here.
Yes. Hare Krishna, thank you very much, Maharaj, for the wonderful class and message. So we have a very special guest with us, Raghunath Prabhu from Amritsar. So Raghunath Prabhu, I am unmuting you, and please ask the question, Prabhu.
Thank you, Maharaj. I really appreciate hearing this class. Maharaj, you mentioned that, you know, the effect of the Navagraha, while devotees don't completely deny that, at the same time, we don't get overwhelmed by those influences. But, you know, due to previous conditioning, sometimes there are some devotee families, they are so controlled by astrology, especially when it comes to getting their sons and daughters married. And, you know, they give up so many good alliances sometimes. And ultimately, children, even their daughters, get married to some non-devotee families because they can't find the right astrological, you know, suitable prospect within the congregations. You know? Now, I'm not trying to criticize anything like that, but I'm just saying, how much as devotees do we, even though we know that planets have a very huge influence on one's bearings, how much do we as devotees try to, you know, actually get influenced by that? Because we also hear that, you know, in pure devotees' cases, planetary conjunctions don't have any effect. They're not pure devotees. So how do we actually interpret this, Maharaj?
Okay, thank you, Raghunath Prabhu. I'll repeat your question because there are also devotees in other platforms who are hearing this who are not on the Zoom call. Your question is that whilst we are devotees and we want to be under the influence of Krishna Graha or Krishna, and some devotees, because of old conditioning, give undue emphasis to astrology, especially when it comes to making matches for marriage. So how does one understand this and what should be the right approach? So Raghunath Prabhu, have I paraphrased and summarized your question correctly?
Completely, Maharaj. Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay. So I will tell you what I would, my view on this is to how much importance we should give to astrology. I would use the Sanskrit term madhyam, intermediate. That means medium importance. We should not be totally dismissive of astrology, and at the same time, we should not be overly influenced by it. We should consider the circumstances. We should consider astrology as being one factor. We should not mistake the astrological compatibility or incompatibility as the sole or the most important factor in taking decisions. It is one factor. And at times, there may be other factors that may overwhelm this factor. For example, if the devotion is exceptionally strong, or if there is exceptional mercy and blessings, then one can overcome the risks, the problems, or the potential hazards associated with astrological incompatibilities or problems. So, yes, ultimately, we want to be under Krishna Graha, and selectively, very carefully, we can utilize this. It is just like a Vedic science, you know, just like we use some Vedic sciences, or we use any material science, basically, for so many things, like building a house, or we need engineering knowledge, or we need, for medical science, we take some knowledge from the material world. Even if it's not Ayurveda, we may use sometimes modern medicine also. So we are utilizing some knowledge from the secular world. And here, Jyotish Shastra is one of the Vedas. So certainly we cannot dismiss it as being unauthentic. The problem comes when we lose a sense of proportion. When we give disproportionate emphasis to astrology and we make that the sole criterion for determining everything, we get obsessed by that. Just like some devotees become obsessed with Vastu Shastra to the point of, you know, neglecting everything else. That is also not correct. So astrology, what I'm saying for astrology also works for Vastu. For Vastu, when we're starting some construction, etc., it's good to incorporate that because you have the flexibility, you have the freedom, you have the opportunity now to include that. Okay, so you can use it, but to break down your building and make something new because it's not practical for Vastu. So similarly with astrology, we should not give disproportionate emphasis. We have to consider the situation. We have to consider the devotional aspect of it. At the same time, complete rejection also may not be very advisable. So that would be my take on this.
Thank you so much, Maharaj. That is very, very clear now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. There is one final question. One devotee is asking if you could shed some more light on the word Naisargika, which you used in the class.
Okay. So the question here is, can you elaborate on the word Naisargika? the word Naisargika, as I said in the class, comes from Nisarga. So we have all heard the word Sarga, which refers to creation, Sarga. Atra Sarga Visargas Cha Sthanam Poshanam Utayaha Manmantaro Ishanu Katha Rodha Mukti Rashraya, right? In the 10 subjects that are discussed in the Srimad Bhagavatam, the first is Nisarga, the second is Visarga. So Sarga refers to the creation of Mahavishnu, Visarga refers to the creation of Brahma, which is a secondary creation. So similarly, in this the world, the nature around us on the earth is called Nisarga or Prakriti. And in natural everyday language, we refer to Prakriti or nature as Nisarga. So when we say something is natural, we mean that it is spontaneous. It doesn't arise because of, shall we say, some rules or regulations or some artificial imposition or something like that. It arises out of something spontaneous and natural to that entity. So Prahlad Maharaj's devotion was Naisargikihi. Naisargiki Ratihi. So that Rati or attraction to Krishna was spontaneous. As Prahlad tells Shanda and Amarka, his teachers, when they ask him that who has taught you all this? Have our enemies come in disguise and told you all this? So Prahlad, in the course of that reply, also mentions that he can't help it. He's helpless, he says. Because my attraction to the Lord is natural. It is spontaneous. Inasmuch as a piece of iron is naturally attracted to a magnet, so also my consciousness is naturally attracted to Krishna. So why is an iron piece attracted to a magnet? That is its nature. So it is a kind of swadharma. It is the dharma of that iron piece to be attracted to the magnet. So there is only one condition in which the iron is not attracted to the magnet, and that is an artificial condition in which the iron is covered by rust. So similarly, the natural swadharma of the soul is to be attracted to Krishna. And the only reason the soul is not attracted to Krishna is because it is in conditioned life and there is a rust of material consciousness. So when that material consciousness is removed, then the natural swadharma, the naisargiki ratihi, that natural swadharma automatically emerges. So that happens by the chanting of the holy names and so on and other devotional practices. As Srila Prabhupada has mentioned in his lecture that the chanting of Hare Krishna is not an artificial imposition. So what is Prahlad is actually manifesting the true qualities of the soul, the natural quality of the soul, the swadharma of the soul. And that is how his devotion is spontaneously coming out. Okay, so we will stop here. And I see that in the chat box, you have a Veda Varsity and the details of all the courses going on. That's excellent.
Thank you very much, Maharaj. We are very, very grateful for sharing the wonderful wisdom from Srimad Bhagavatam with all of us. I also thank all the devotees who have joined today for this wonderful session. And we have shared the list of courses in the chat box. Kindly go through them. And these are the courses which are conducted by devotees who are expert in those particular fields. They have rich experience in teaching and practice of scriptures. So we are ISKCON Bhagavat Mahavidyalaya, and Vedvarsity is an online initiative of the ISKCON Bhagavat Mahavidyalaya, which represents the online education forum. And it aims at the worldwide distribution of wisdom from Vedic scriptures. So we once again thank His Holiness Bhakti Rasamrita Swami Maharaj for joining us as he has given his precious time. And we also thank all of you for joining. And I would request Maharaj that please give us your association regularly. We'll be very, very grateful, and our life will be enriched by association of wonderful Vaishnava like you. So thank you very much, Maharaj. And also thanks to all the devotees who have joined today. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gaur Premanande. Hari Hari Bol. Hare Krishna.